Well, here we are. The fifth and final season has come to an end. 156. That's so many episodes we've journeyed through. And today, I'll be honouring the last 36 of them. First, as always, we will start with the episodes by score. And the episodes always get dropped into four categories, so let's go through that. First, in the 0 out of 3 category, the bottom of the barrel, we had 6 episodes, or 17% of the season. Last Night of a Jockey, The Seventh is Made Up of Phantoms, Black Leather Jackets, Sounds and Silences, Come Wander With Me, The Bewitching Pool. Then, in the 1 out of 3 category, we had 10 episodes, or 28% of the season. A Kind of a Stopwatch, The Old Man in the Cave, Probe 7, Over and Out, 90 Years Without Slumbering, Renadine Girl, The Self-Improvement of Salvador Ross, Spur of the Moment, Caesar and Me, The Jeopardy Room, The Encounter. Then, we have the 2 out of 3 category. Here we had 13 episodes, or 36%, and this was the largest category this season. In Praise of Pip, Nightmare at 20,000 Feet, Uncle Simon, You Drive, Number 12 Looks Just Like You, Night Call, From Agnes with Love, What's in the Box, I Am the Night, Colour Me Black, Stop Over in a Quiet Tone, Mr. Garrity and the Graves, The Brain Centre at Whipples, The Fear. And finally, we have the 3 out of 3 category, the cream of the crop for this season. Here we had 7 episodes, or 19%. Steel, Living Doll, A Short Drink from a Certain Fountain, The Long Morrow, An Occurrence at Owl Creek Bridge, Queen of the Nile, The Masks. And here, of course, is a pie chart. Next, as always, we shall look back at the authors who contributed to this season. The Twilight Zone always was, in my humble opinion, a showcase for authors to demonstrate and share their stories with the world. And here are the 12 authors who made up season 5. First, we had Robert Enrico, who wrote 1 episode, or 3%. Mr. Enrico comes into the Twilight Zone, largely in thanks to a good judgment call on Mr. Serling, who got the rights to show off his gorgeous film in North America. And it is gorgeous. What more needs to be said? While not technically on staff to write for the show, he has a place of distinction in my mind. Next we have Jerry McNeely, who wrote 1 episode, or 3%. Had to be honest, I had to remind myself which episode he wrote, because it was very forgettable. His Twilight Zone episode was actually one of his earliest credits, but he went on to write for several other shows through the 60s and 70s. His story was based on another tale as well, so I can't even credit him with the interesting concept. Next we have Richard D. Roy, who wrote 1 episode, or 3%. There's actually an interesting story tied to this author. This was originally a script written by George Clayton Johnson, who was responsible for 4 other tales in the franchise, originally titled Tick of Time. The producer for this season didn't care for his work, and brought in a new writer to redo the script, which turned into the bland, boring tale Mr. Roy churned out. What a shame. A great what could have been. Next we have Bernard C. Schoenfeld, who wrote 1 episode, or 3%. An author whose most interesting work seemed to be for Alfred Hitchcock Presents, Mr. Schoenfeld produced a surprising comedy story. Surprising because it was actually decently funny. With only 1 episode, it's hard to gauge his overall prowess, but at least his contribution was a positive one. Next is Adele T. Strassfield, who wrote 1 episode, or 3%. The only female writer the series ever had, Miss Strassfield was actually the secretary for a producer and wrote a total of 3 scripts in her writing career, the first being for The Twilight Zone. It wasn't a very good tale, and we seem to have come a long way for a show that started out as a fairly exclusive club of authors Mr. Serling respected. Next is John Tomerlin, who wrote one episode, or 3%. Despite writing this all on his own, using Mr. Beaumont's tale as source material, he had to share writing credit for his teleplay with someone who couldn't have possibly contributed, given his health. That must be rough. Mr. Tomlin wrote a really cool piece, and clearly understood what worked on the show, even if it wasn't a flawless performance. Next, we have Anthony Wilson, who wrote one episode, or 3%. Did you know Mr. Wilson created the Planet of the Apes television series? Did you know there was one? Based on his abysmally terrible work for The Twilight Zone, I'd be reluctant to watch it. Maybe he had a terrible story about an idiot musician on that show too. Next, we have Martin M. Goldsmith, who wrote two episodes, or 5%. Mr. Goldsmith clearly had his finger on the pulse when it came to understanding the ideals of the show. He had very strong themes in his episodes, but with only two tales to go off of, one good and one bad, I would have to say that his finger was only loosely on the pulse of actual execution. Nevertheless, Mr. Goldsmith is one of the more positive additions to the writing roster. Next, we have Jerry Soule, ghostwriter for Charles Beaumont, who wrote two episodes, or 5%. Mr. Soule is back to do some more ghostwriting, and a look back on his work reveals that this was a man who knew his horror stories. Now, that's all he did, so he came off as a little one-note, but stick to what you're good at, right? A good story is a good story, and I was always happy to see the fake Beaumont credit, because it meant Mr. Soule was there to spook us. Next, we have Richard Matheson, who wrote four episodes, or 11%. I've gushed over Mr. Matheson throughout the show, and he's delivered some great stories here as well. His final episode offering was really weak, and it's sad that he ended on such a low note. But this season offered some great tales, and almost all of his contributions to this series are worth celebrating. Next, we have Earl Hamner Jr., who wrote five episodes, or 14%. What's the world coming to when Mr. Hamner is the second most prolific writer for the season? He's wrote eight episodes overall. Six of them are the worst thing ever. I don't want to say that you can measure the fall of the show by how much he appeared, but, well, I guess I just did. And finally, we have Rod Serling, who wrote 16 episodes, or 44% of the season. With the return to the half-hour format, Mr. Serling was able to find his footing much more easily this time around. His fatigue is starting to show, but can you blame him? Could I have written 92 short stories, some of which are still marvelous classics today, in 5 years and done any better? I don't know. I don't think so. Mr. Serling has been an inspiration, not just in his storytelling chops, but also in his sheer passion in keeping the show alive despite diversity, and pouring his heart and soul into teaching us about human nature. And of course, backed by popular demand, a pie chart. And now, of course, the moment you've all been waiting for. Along the bumpy road of season 5, which episodes have been the bumpiest? Let's find out. Here is my top 3 worst episodes of season 5. In third place, Last Night of a Jockey, episode 125, written by Rod Serling.
For the unpleasant realization that all your life you've had to stand on tiptoe to look at what's around you.
I wish you were here right now. Hear me? Hear me? I wish you were here right now.
Just look down. Under your feet. Mr. Grady, you know what you want. You want to be respected. Up on a horse, you're a man. On the ground, you're a half-pint.
Shut up! Shut
up! This doesn't even feel like an episode. It feels like they caught Mickey Rooney doing some sort of improv thing and turned the camera on. Nothing in this episode makes sense, and every narrative decision was the wrong decision. The single room and single character setup feels cheap and impassionate, like Mr. Serling really wanted to take the week off and toss this out at the last minute. Don't waste your time or energy on this one. The creator sure didn't. In second place, Black Leather Jackets, episode 138, written by Earl Hamner Jr. Speaking of wrong decisions, let's talk about the decision to let Earl Hamner Jr. write for The Twilight Zone. I would love to say that this abomination of a tale was an exception, but no, this was pretty bog standard at this point. A cliché story about an alien falling in love with a human, with terrible dialogue, completely nonsensical build-up and threat, and the dumbest villain, which, if you've bleached the episode from your mind, was a big eyeball on a screen. Sorry, you'll have to grab the bleach again. I hate this episode with every fiber of my being. And the worst episode of season 5 is The Bewitching Pool, episode 156, written by Earl Hamner Jr.
Now, while they're settling their difficulties, you can finish icing the cake.
Thank you, ma'am.
And when the two come back, if they have any teeth left in their heads after the bout, they can help us eat it. My, you are very accomplished. Have you had much experience with cakes?
No, ma'am. This is my first one.
One would never guess it. Oh, what? Back already?
We didn't go yet.
Okay, I hate this one a lot more. Which served as the final nail in the coffin when it should have been a victory lap for this incredible series. This is a full 3-strikes-and-you're-out setup. Not only was the concept and story an absolute mess, not only was the dialogue and characters abysmal and uninteresting, but the production quality of the episode was embarrassingly bad. It feels like an amateur production that a couple of film students sent into CBS that got accidentally aired. If this was where the show might have gone, I'm glad there's no season 6. But let's change the mood. There was some smooth sailing as well, and these tales guaranteed a good time. Here is my top 3 best episodes of season 5. In third place, An Occurrence at Owl Creek Bridge, episode 142, written by Robert Enrico, based on a short story by Ambrose Bierce. This feels like cheating just a bit, since technically this was an independent French film first, but hey, it aired in the Twilight Zone, so it counts. So many storytellers and content creators in general are afraid of minimalism. There's a fear that silence or space will cause an audience to wander off and lose interest. And that can be true, but an invested audience will stay with it and want to go on the journey, even if much of that journey is in quiet contemplation. The almost purely visual tale does a great job capturing the image of a man's last moments. There's a lot we don't get to know, but I think what we do see will burn its way into your mind. In second place, Steel, episode 122, written by Richard Matheson.
Fix it.
Steel, I...
Fix it.
Steel, I can't.
Look, you broke it, now you fix it!
Let go of me.
Don't you understand? It's gotta be fixed. It's
gotta be fixed. No spring.
Then get one.
They don't have them here, don't you understand? They don't make them anymore.
Season 5 at its worst felt like a cruel joke, but at its best, it felt like a mournful swan song. The poignant episodes dealt with themes of loss and longing, and Steel was no exception, as we journeyed with a man whose passion in life had been taken from him, and what was in its place was a beaten and broken down android. The episode invites you to mourn what has been lost, but also to cherish each moment and make the best of it, because who knows when it will end. If you persevere through this tale of human perseverance, I promise you won't be disappointed. And the best episode of Season 5 is... The Long Morrow, Episode 135, written by Rod Serling.
It's more than just void, darkness, unconsciousness. The mind does work. There are images, patterns, things to recollect. It's not just the long, deep sleep that comes when the fear has left. The cold is felt, the slipping away of feeling is noted and then succumbed to. The mind functions. Time is distorted, jumbled, telescoped, accordion, but there is a sense of time even so.
Once in a while, true art is made. A tale that connects intellectually and emotionally. For all the times Mr. Sterling's fatigue came through this season, episode 135 was not one of them. And this episode deserves to be hung in an art gallery as much as it deserves to be on this list. Is it the best episode ever? No. But it is one of the best, and shines through especially strong in such a turbulent and uneven season. The story is vibrant and moving. The characters are passionate and sympathetic. And the dialogue, the dialogue is poetry. If there is an episode in season 5 that you watch, pick this one. And that's all, folks. That's the 5th and final season of The Twilight Zone. But it's not the end. We still have the series retrospective coming up. Stay tuned.